we need to understand and walk in the glory of God in these last days. And we begin with the red blood moon. This has now become a marker, universally recognized marker among all Christians who watch prophecy. These red blood moons are recognized as a marker in time. They are announcing a shift in the season. What shift in the season are they bringing about? These are the things they taught in the national prayer gathering. According to the series of prophetic teachers, one of them, Abrams, and then Pastor Joe Sweet, another was Pastor Neville Johnson from Australia, all agree that the season will bring about a new heightened season of the goodness and severity of God. The red blood moon is a marker for a season of the goodness and severity of God in a much increased measure. We will see escalation of the goodness and severity of God depending on which side of the equation you are. In 1 Samuel chapter 6 verses 1 to 6, we have here an idea of the goodness and severity of God happening at the same time. When the Ark of the Covenant was brought to Philippine territory and it brought about curses in their household, they wanted to return it to Israel and they gathered as to what should be done. And there was a discussion recorded in 1 Samuel chapter 6 verses 1 to 6 where some of them said something like this. Verse 4, the Philistines asked, "What guilt offering should we send him?" They replied, 5 gold tumors and 5 gold rats according to the number of the Philistine rulers, because the same plague has struck both you and your rulers. Make models of the tumors and the rats that are destroying the country and pay honor to Israel's God. Perhaps he will lift his hand from you and your gods and your land. Why do you harden your hearts as the Egyptians and Pharaoh did when he treated them harshly? The Egyptians, did they not send the Israelites out so they could go on their way? Here in this one verse is the severity and the goodness of God. The severity of God on the Egyptians and Pharaohs, at the same time, his goodness towards the Israelites. In this prophetic season, we will see the severity and goodness of God at the same time. It's going to enter into the season marked by the turning of the red blood moon. If you will check the history of the red blood moon, there are records of the severity and goodness of God on a grand scale. The first red blood moon happened when Jesus was crucified. The severity of God was seen on Jesus Christ, the sin bearer. God, in his holiness, poured out all the holy wrath of God on sin when he allowed Jesus to be brutally crucified on the cross. Jesus became the sin bearer. That was the severity of God. But goodness for the sinners, because their salvation has now come. As we move on to the timeline, the 1948 red blood moon, we saw the severity on the nations that attacked Israel. 6 mighty Arab nations defeated by God decisively. And we saw the goodness of God to Israel and the church. The same in 1967, the severity of God and the goodness of God. This is what happened. If you will remember history, when 1948 came and Israel was reborn, this was the same year that marked the beginning of the phenomenon of mass evangelism in the church, where thousands and millions attend crusades and rally. Starting with Billy Graham, his first crusade was in 1948. Sila Oral Roberts, Morris Cirulo, so forth and so on. The phenomenon of massive crowds began in 1948 when Israel was reborn. So when something good happens to Israel, something good happens to the church. This was the season of massive million attendance, mass evangelism activities. But this was also the time of the greatest persecution in the history of Christianity, the Iron Curtain persecution, where estimated 12 million Christians were killed by communism from 1948 to the 1980s. This was a severity that did not come from God, but was allowed by God. So you have two great things happening. The glory of the Lord seen in the mass evangelism, where hundreds and thousands and millions of souls were being saved, while there was persecution on Christians also in the communist world. Right now, there is a resurgence of persecutions against Christians in many parts of the world. It's not being recorded. This is a 2013 incident when Pakistani Christians were victimized in one bomb attack. 80 plus of them were killed and they had to bury them. And this is not being recorded in the mainstream media. Just would like us to look at the map of Christian persecution in the world today so that when the severity of the season comes and escalate, we will have an idea of where most probably the areas of severity may come. This is the color coding of persecution of Christians in the world. The darker the color, the extreme the persecution. Severe persecution is the orange color. The moderate persecution is this, and the sparse persecution. If you notice, the Philippines is here. It's colored white. There is no persecution of Christians here. This is the most severe persecution of Christians in the world. These are Islamic Arab countries. This is communist country. This is Russia. So there has been a relaxation of persecution in Russia, but with the Ukraine problem, it's starting all over again. And Israel is there. Israel is there. If you notice, Israel is in the middle of two friendly places, North America and the Philippines. So it's just right in the middle. They can either go there for refuge or go to the Philippines for refuge. According to Frank Abrams, that Jewish speaker that we had in the national prayer gathering, there is more love for Israel in the Philippines than in America. He felt that Israelites are more loved here than in the United States of America because there is a growing popularity of Islam and Muslim faith even in the United States, which they suspect is being encouraged by the presidency of President Obama. Then in 1967, when Jerusalem was recaptured, you saw the birth of the charismatic movement, the Jesus movement, and the era of the restoration of the gifts of the Holy Spirit. Speaking in tongues was restored, healing was restored, power evangelism was restored, praise and worship was restored, deliverance ministry was restored when Jerusalem was recovered. But the enemy also counterattacked with a revolution in sex, in drugs, marijuana, rock and roll revolution. This also started the Islamic persecution of Christians. Again, the severity did not come from God, but was allowed by God. So there is both a season, basta may red blood moon, there is immediately following a season of severity and a season of goodness. That is what happened in 1967. So what is going to be expected in this red blood moon of 2014-2015? What's going to happen to Israel, to the church, to the world, to the Philippines? What goodness will this season bring and what severity will this season bring? This is their prognosis. This is what the teachers there predicted, or maybe you can call it prophesied, but I would rather say what they forecast after this red blood moon 2014-2015. On the severity side, they said that there will be so much increase of birth pain signs. There is some discussion that this will see the beginning of the tribulation period. There will be an increase in moral evil. There will be an increase in spiritual and demonic activities. There will be increase in calamities. There will be a soon and coming economic collapse and social disorder, famines, pestilences, and diseases on the severity side. On the goodness side, there is an expectation of the fulfillment of the prophetic outpouring of Joel chapter 2. Those who are open to the Holy Spirit will operate more in dreams, visions, prophesying, etc. There will be an increase in the intervening acts of God for His people. There will be an emergence of a bridal church. There will be increase in angelic and spirit, Holy Spirit activities. There will be establishment of Goshens and Arks. There is an entire train of teaching on the concept of Goshen and the concept of Ark. Because we are going into a season of severity, there should be places and situations which are equivalent to Goshen and Ark. That's an entirely new teaching. We cannot take that up now. The provision for the church is expected to be poured out in the times of the goodness of the Lord, because the Israelites, when they came out of Egypt, were richly provided by the Lord. And there is also going to be a great harvest. And they will happen side by side. They will happen side by side. Seasons of severity, seasons of goodness of the Lord. It will also be a season of vengeance and redemption. There's kind of similar, but not exactly similar. They are treated separately in different parts of the Bible. In Isaiah chapter 63, verses 1 to 4, there is a prophetic passage where the Lord is pictured out as coming from Edom, from Bosra, with his garments stained in crimson, and he is treading the winepress because he is ready to trample the nations in his anger and to tread them down in his wrath. Their blood spattered over his garments, and he stained all his clothing. For the day of vengeance was in the heart of the Lord, and the year of redemption has come. Day of vengeance is the same time as the year of redemption. So this is very crucial. Isaiah chapter 63 verses 6 to 9 says that when he tramples the nations in his anger and he pours their blood on the ground, there is another side to that same phenomenon whereby the kindness of the Lord and his deeds are to be praised. According to all the Lord has done for us, yes, the many good things he has done for Israel. Please take note that we believers are engrafted into Israel. So the promises for Israel are also for us, according to his compassion and many kindnesses. So in verse 6, you have the severity of God. In verse 7, the goodness of God. The vengeance of God, the redemption, redemptive acts of God. He said, surely they are my people, children who will be true to me. And so he became their savior. In all their distress, he too was distressed. And the angel of his presence saved them. In his love and mercy, he redeemed them. He lifted them up and carried them all the days of old. The angel of his presence is a phenomenon that the prophetic teachers expect to increase as a result of the entry of the tetrad. There will be more who will experience the phenomenon of the angel of the presence of the Lord. Now, what is the meaning of the angel of the presence of the Lord? Some people say it is an angel representing the Lord. Other people say, no, it is the Lord himself manifesting, because the word angel simply means messenger. So, in the Bible, there are situations where an appearance is called angel of the Lord, but it was actually the Lord. Whatever your interpretation is, there will be an increase of experience in this phenomenon called the angel of the presence of the Lord in a time when the day of vengeance happens side by side with the year of redemption. So, it will be a time of great upheavals and great deliverances. If the upheaval becomes great, the deliverance becomes great. The difficulty becomes great, the deliverance becomes greater. There is going to be a matching of the goodness and redemption of God to accompany the severity of the times and the vengeance happening on the other side. So this is illustrated by the crossing of the Red Sea. When